Hi, Paul Sackett's Good News Broadcast, speaking to Susan Wiggs. Hi, Susan, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you for having me.
I love speaking with you. You're just a breath of fresh air. And you've written a new book, right? Congratulations.
I have, thank you. Today is the official publication date of Just Breathe.
Okay. Okay, and if I breathe, what will happen?
You will magically find the rest of your life to be just a glorious ride into the sunset.
Okay, all right. Is that what happens in your book with somebody?
I like to think so. I like to think after all the trials and tribulations of poor Sarah in Just Breathe, she finds her happily ever after. I hope readers think so.
Okay, all righty. So let's see here. What's Just Breathe about? Sarah Moon, a successful comic strip illustrator? Okay.
Yep. She has a cool job.
Yeah, all right. That's a nice... comics are so popular now, aren't they?
Well, they are, and I love giving characters jobs that I would like to have.
Okay.
You know, who didn't sit and doodle comic strips when they were a kid, you know?
Okay. I did, but I'm like a stick figure person, and I was always embarrassed to show anybody, though.
I know, and I desperately wanted to have comic strips in the book, and so I wrote the words, and I described the blurb, and I tried to draw them, and, you know, I give props to comic strip artists, because it's a lot harder than it looks, and, you know, I tried to draw, and ultimately I had to go to my publisher, and I said, look, I really want comic strips to be part of this book. They introduce each section of the book, real ones, and I said, but I can't, for the life of me, I cannot draw them. I know, I can see it in my head, but I can't get it down on paper. Which is a lot of what people say to me about writing books, but comic strips couldn't do it. And I was so lucky because the creative art director at my publisher is a very fine artist in his own right and also draws comic strips.
Right, great.
And so he created the characters, and they're so great. In the book, to me, they look exactly like they should.
All right.
They look like you could see it in any newspaper.
Well, congratulations. They are beautiful. Let me ask you a question, because this is unusual. You went to Harvard, right?
I did, yes. And many moons ago. Graduated in 1980.
And you don't usually, I don't know, Harvard/romance novels.
Yeah, they don't really claim me. You know, books by members, they have a section in their magazine. I don't think I've ever seen my name there.
Okay, but you've written a few books in your life, right?
I have. This is like number 30-something, I believe.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't count anymore because it makes me feel old.
How do you, how do you continue with fresh ideas? And so right now, are you in the middle of another book?
I always am, yes. And that's actually why I'm on the radio as opposed to on the road doing, you know, book signings in bookstores, because I have a book deadline. I have a novel coming out next winter as well. It's a winter love story called Fireside. Mm-hmm. And so I'm just finishing up with that, chained to my computer.
Okay. Isn't it hard, though, to get a book published? Actually, I'm trying to help a friend, and I have a book idea myself with Good News. But I haven't really worked hard. I'm trying with him because he has some kind of a unique situation, but it's not so easy.
No, you know what? If it was easy, everybody would be a published author because it's darn fun, you know? It really is. And so, but it's kind of a mystical process, I would say, especially, gosh, back when I got started in the 80s, we didn't have the internet, you know, you couldn't email your favorite author, and, you know, you couldn't access publishers the way that you can now with the internet, but it's still difficult because it's really kind of like lining up the perfect deal in any business. You got to line up the right talent with the right publisher, you know, and the right emphasis and that sort of thing. And so it takes a lot of finesse. And I give a lot of credit for my career to not just me writing the books, but to the team that I work with, my literary agent. That's sort of like the real estate agent who puts together the deal. Mm-hmm. And then the publisher, which does all the rest. And this publisher has done such a great job making each book feel like an event. You know, even though I've written 30-something books, they make each one special. And so I really give props to them. Now, finding them, that's gosh, it's a it's a combination of networking, you know, talking to people, emailing them. People can email me through my website, SusanWiggs.com, if they have uh-huh. questions. And meeting people at conferences. You know, I assume they have, like, broadcasting conferences and things like that, so they have that for writing as well.
Okay.
There are probably local workshops in any community. You know, as small as Bainbridge Island is, we have a writer's community called Fields End, and we give classes and lectures and things, and we're affiliated with the library. So community resources are always great to start with, and a lot of persistence, you know. I think that people telling you no, oh gosh, I'm going to misquote this guy, but he's the guy who has the big book out, Randy Pausch,
okay.
who wrote that book called The Last Lecture. He was diagnosed with terminal cancer.
Oh, right, yes, okay, yes.
He wrote that, and he said, you know, people telling you no is just a test to see how bad you want something.
Okay.
And you have to be prepared for it. Probably this is the case in broadcasting as well. A lot of people to turn you away or turn you down, say no thank you, that's not for us. You know, just be prepared to hear this a lot because, you know, there are just a lot of gatekeepers in this industry and you got to get past a lot of them. And so it's, you know, I'm not saying it's easy, but it's so incredibly rewarding. It's really, it's a gratifying career. It's frustrating. You're an independent contractor, you're self-employed, and so that comes with a lot of headaches, but a lot of rewards, too. So I recommend it. Keep at it.
Well, it's all about passion, I think, also, and it's a good word, too. You really have, I mean, to find what you love to do, I mean...
Yes.
I've somehow stayed in my own business. I was with 14 years with CBS and PBS, and 23 years in my own business. I feel like I've been unemployed for 23 years. And
either you never go to work or you never leave work. I can't decide which it feels like.
It is a wild event. Tell us a little more about the book. How's it come together, and some thoughts to share with our audience.
Oh, well, this book in particular is a very personal story from the heart. And I say it's personal even though it's about the way a woman deals with a devastating life crisis. It's the breakup of her marriage mm-hmm. and how she picks up the shattered pieces of her life and moves on. And I've never experienced that. I've been married 28 years. Mm-hmm. But I would say that probably half of my friends have endured, you know, a marital crisis and had to reinvent themselves and their relationships and their lives in the wake of a big trauma like this. So
sure.
That's why I say it's a really deeply personal issue, and I just wanted to explore it in Just Breathe. It's something that's happened to people I know and people I care about, and I didn't want to make light of anything about it, but in the book, her great inner strength is her humor. You know, she's this comic strip artist by trade. And so writing her story for me was a real balancing act between, you know, balancing the dark and the light and not making it too depressing
uh-huh.
To see this woman kind of knocked in the dust and having to pick herself up. I hope by the end it's an uplifting and uh-huh. hopeful story.
Well, sometimes they say that it's time that will heal these kinds of wounds. Or they say that until you find another love for your life, then, you know, it's sort of... changes things. How did you see that in your conversations with people in this regard?
I did, and I saw the whole spectrum. You know, I saw women, and I say women because this is really, she's the main character, but there are very strong male characters in there, including a guy who's restoring a Mustang, a 1969 Mustang, which is cool. And then the main, the hero of the story, Will, is a firefighter. But ultimately, I really focused on the woman's journey because, you know, you only have so much story you can put into a book.
Mm-hmm.
And so I did. I really picked my friends' brains, I hope in a good way. They didn't mind. I always, you know,
I'm
told
sure
them what I was up to.
You are a very sensitive writer, and you have, we've been talking for a long time.
Yes, we have.
Gorgeous cover. You. What a beautiful. Look at this woman.
Doesn't that.
Bearing all.
No. Awesome.
Not bearing all. I don't know. Not totally. She's out there, and it's a beautiful beach. Where's that beach? Is that a real
beach
somewhere?
No, that is actually a piece of stock art, you know, stock
wow,
photo art that my publisher rendered for the cover, but it turned out to be, I think, the perfect image for this book. It just kind of embodies the whole feeling.
It does.
It looks like a day at the beach. It looks like this woman is, you know, about to take a deep breath and take
yes.
a plunge, you
it's
know?
Fantastic. Susan, let me let you go because I know you've got a lot of people to talk to. Love speaking with you and look forward to speaking with you and sharing your good news again.
Oh, thank you so much. I really appreciate being on the show.
Okay, take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.